To deliver the welcome report for the student chapter inauguration of Trivandrum Management Association at Asian School of Business. First of all, on behalf of ASB family, I welcome Sri Chandrasekhar sir, Vice Chairman, Mr. Suresh Babu, TMA President, and Basant, Joint Secretary, and Krishna Nair sir, Secretary, who agreed to facilitate the program. And I also welcome all TMA members, faculties, and students. Thank you.
I call upon Mr. K.M. Chandrasekhar, Vice Chairman, State Planning Board, Kerala, to inaugurate the function. We welcome you, sir.
Good to see all of you here today. I think it's an important event in the ongoing history of the Asian School of Business. You're all going to be future managers, and you require certain skills that are particularly relevant to Kerala, particularly relevant to our country. I think that kind of skill that you require, certainly you will find a lot of value added by tying yourself with the Trivandrum Management Association. I think all the management associations in the state that I've attended, I've spoken to quite a few. All of them do have a very significant role to play in promoting the concept and practices of management. I think above all, what they do is expose management to new changes and to new ideas, not only that have emerged in this country, but new ideas that have emerged in other countries, in other places. They're able to bring all that wisdom here and give a new dimension to our own thinking on management. I'm therefore happy that the Trivandrum Management Association has taken one step forward by creating a student chapter. I don't know whether the student chapter is exclusively for the...
No, we are in all of other institutions also.
All other institutions also. So we are only making a beginning. And I think this will be a huge and important event for me. And since Mr. Vijay Sinha, the speaker of today, is only here, I think I have nothing further to say except that I'm very happy to have inaugurated the student. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to call upon Mr. Suresh Babu, TMA President, to address the gathering.
Chapter of Audio Management Association,
which is the body of the Practicing Managers of India. We regularly conduct evening lecture programs, workshops, trainings, and also we have an annual convention, that is our flagship program. I think we'll have we are planning to have two major programs. One is in association with Project Management Association. We are planning to have a 3-day program of mortality and project management. I think that will be mostly in the month of May. This year's management convention, that is going to be our flagship program every year. So we are planning to have planning to discuss this time on different development models we have adopted in Kerala. So looking for the help of Planning Commission also in arranging this year's flagship program somewhere in June and July. We are discussing with Planning Commission also on this year's program. Thank you. I think we have been discussing with other institutions, College of Engineering, Trivandrum, the University Institute of Management, and DC College of Management. I think some of the students from Kerala University also here. So we have recently had on Management Day, we have conducted a quiz for the students programs. I think today we are distributing the certificates of winners. So I request all student members to participate regularly in our evening lecture programs, mostly on management topics. Thank you, madam.
Next, I would like to call upon Nakesh Sanal for the vote of thanks.
Propose a word of thanks. Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. Chandrasekhar Sir, Vice Chairman, Kerala Planning Board Commission, for finding your busy, finding time from your busy schedules, and Professor Yaji Sir, Director of ASB, for providing all the facilities. EMA President Sunil Prabhu Sir, EMA Joint Secretary Mr. Basil Kumar, and Krishna Nair Sir, TMA Secretary, for all your efforts and cooperation making this student chapter a grand success. And also, I would like to thank each and every one of you who are gathered here. Thank you all.
Welcome back. Let's start off with our session, Kerala State Planning Board lectures by Sri UK Sinha, Chairman SEBI, on how SMEs and startups can raise money from the market. I welcome Professor Rajiv, Director, Asian School of Business, for the welcome address.
Okay, it's my pleasure and privilege to invite Mr. Sinha, as well as the other distinguished members of the people on the dais, to this meeting. First, Mr. Sinha, as the chairman of SEBI, it's a pleasure to have you on board here because this is a terrific opportunity for young people, both students as well as entrepreneurs in Trivandrum, to hear from the horse's mouth, what exactly happens with the fundraising activity as far as the SEBI's perspective goes. Mr. Sinha has been a career IAS officer, and he has been in the finance area for many years, and so he has some other connections here. Srimati Anuradha Balaram used to work for him earlier, so she was telling me what a pleasure it was to work for such a wonderful, methodical, and precise person who is able to take things forward without any flaws. Also, I wanted to mention that you may have heard about SEBI recently in the context of Mr. Subrata Roy and the problems that he had with Sahara. And it's interesting that we have a connection there. The individual who had done a lot to bring Mr. Roy to book was a gentleman named Dr. K.M. Abraham, who was a former faculty of ours. He's an IAS officer, and he took a year off, and he taught finance here. So it's interesting that SEBI is an entity that has a lot of teeth. That's what was demonstrated by what happened in the Sahara case. You know, you mess with SEBI at your own risk, so let that be a word of caution to all of you who are in the entrepreneurial mode. And we also have, of course, the Honorable Vice Chairman of the State Planning Board, Mr. Chandrasekhar, who has very kindly agreed to have this event held here, although many of the, or most of the Planning Board events are held at the Mascot Hotel or something by the Planning Board itself. We're delighted and we're very happy to be able to host this event here. And that's partly thanks to Mr. Vijayaraghavan, who's not here today, who's also on the planning board. Then we have Mr. Balagopal, who, as many of you know, he's been our speaker at our graduation ceremonies in the past. He is an entrepreneur, formerly with the IAS, then he joined, or he started a company called Theramo Penpol, which many of you are familiar with, which has been a great success. Not only that, he is a writer. He just came out of his memoirs last year, and the second volume is expected sometime in the future. And then we have Mr. Sanjay Vijay Kumar, who is the chairman of Startup Village and one of the celebrated entrepreneurs in Kerala, who's done a lot to create a culture of entrepreneurship in Kerala. And last but not least, we have Dr. Anuradha Balaram, who is member secretary to the State Planning Board. And what we're planning to do is to have Mr. Sinha give his lecture. And after that, we will have a small panel discussion. The whole thing will take approximately an hour and a half. And please feel free to ask your questions. Whether you're an entrepreneur or you're a student, please feel free to give us your point of view. So without further ado, let me request Mr. Chandrasekhar to give his opening remarks.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Sinha, Dr. Rajiv, and other distinguished people on the dais, as well as distinguished people sitting that side also. I'm happy that finally we have been able to get UK Sinha to Trivandrum. This has been an ongoing effort for about a couple of years, I think, no?
One year, maybe.
So finally he agreed to come. And I never knew you had such a beautiful auditorium. So it's nice that I'm seeing this auditorium also. It's really, I think the Asian School of Business is certainly on its way up. And I wish it all the best. Now, I have known UK Sinha since the year 2004, when we were both working in the finance ministry. Subsequently, he left the finance ministry. So I was saying that I have known UK Sinha since the year 2004. We were both working together in the finance ministry. Thereafter, he went, when Damodaran went as chairman of SEBI, he then took over as chairman and managing director of the UTI Asset Management Company. He continued there for some time. And then in 2008, he decided to quit the Indian Administrative Service and go as chairman of the Association of Mutual Funds in India. Subsequently, in 2011, February 2011 to be exact, he took over as chairman of SEBI. Now, SEBI, as Dr. Rajiv mentioned earlier, is an organization with a lot of teeth, is an organization that can do a lot of good. And I think during the last 3 years, he has proved exactly that. The Securities and Exchange Board of India Act of 1992, according to the preamble, it is an act to provide for the establishment of a board to protect the interests of investors in securities and to regulate the securities market. He has a regulatory role in respect of stock exchanges and other securities markets, venture capital funds, collective investment schemes, including mutual funds, foreign investors, financial intermediaries, and also this organization is charged with prohibiting fraudulent and unfair trade practices relating to securities markets and promote investor education and training of intermediaries of the securities market. So I think during the last few years, SEBI has certainly played a major role in making life easier for the investors, both Indian and foreign. And this is an ongoing exercise which has gathered a tremendous amount of momentum after Mr. Sinha took over. Now, while making life easier for the investors, he also came down pretty hard on issues relating to fraud and one of these issues Dr. Rajiv had referred to earlier in his welcome address. But there are many other issues also where SEBI has really shown its capability and its strength. Now, as I mentioned, I've tried very hard to get him to Trivandrum to speak to all of us, to speak to industry. Now, he could very well have spoken of his achievements in SEBI and so on, but he thought that what Kerala industry requires today is to know the ways in which small and medium enterprises and startups that dominate the Kerala economy, how they can raise money from the market. So accordingly, that is the subject of his talk today. And I think it vibes well with my own thinking on the subject, because I have always felt that so far as Kerala is concerned, homegrown industry is probably the best solution for taking the process of industrial growth forward. Instead of concentrating too much on trying to get big people from all over the country and all over the world here, I think we should go into a system of trying to develop our own industry, giving them more strength. And I have seen a number of cases where very small industrial units, when I left the state in 1996, had become multinationals by the year 2011. I think Kerala industry has a special culture, and that is best captured by local entrepreneurs. And I'm extremely happy that people like Sanjay Vijay Kumar have really provided a new way of growth, in the sense that startups have started proliferating. And I think these startups are going to give us various new leads into industrial growth in the future. So I'm very happy that Mr. UK Sinha is here. I think he's one of the very few people, maybe the only person, who got kind of commendation from the present finance minister in the budget speech of 2013-14. The finance minister had said, "I believe that India's capital market is among the best regulated," which is very high praise coming from a person who is himself intellectually very strong, and often it's very difficult for him to come out with praise of this kind. So like him, I offer congratulations to SEBI, and I look forward to the lecture that is about to follow. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to invite Sri UK Sinha, Chairman, Securities and Exchange Board of India, to give the lecture on how SMEs and startups can raise money from the market.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's indeed an honor for me to be here today, and I must begin by pleading guilty that in spite of Mr. Chandrasekhar's persistence, it has taken some time for me to be here, but I intend to make it up, and I promise that whenever I'm asked to come again, either here or in any other part of Kerala, I'll be more than happy to come and interact with the industry or others. I will be talking about a little bit about SEBI, and then I'll be talking about what SEBI can do or what is the system in place today for raising money from the market, especially by SMEs. At the end of it, I'm looking forward to a very active question and answer session. However, if during my talk, if anybody feels that he would like to interrupt me and get some clarification, I'm very happy about that as well. As Mr. Chandrasekhar had pointed out, the SEBI Act has given the mandate that we have to protect the interest of the investors, we have to regulate the market, and we have to also promote the growth of the securities market. So there are three different mandates given to SEBI. And at times people question whether these three mandates are contradictory to each other, because some people argue that if you have to regulate, you regulate very strictly, how can you also have a developmental role? But we feel that these three mandates are complementary to each other. There is no confusion or conflict, and SEBI has continuously been trying to meet all the three obligations that the Parliament has given to it. We work under certain acts. Most important is the SEBI Act, and then we have certain sections of the Companies Act which have been given to us for administering. I'll try and avoid very detailed technical matters, but if anybody is interested, I will be more than happy to answer questions on that. So I'm not getting into the chapters and the areas, but on matters of the Companies Act with regard to raising of capital or passing of dividend, etc., that chapter, that portion is administered by SEBI so far as the listed companies are concerned. We also have the Securities Contract Regulation Act, basically governing the working of the stock exchanges in India, and we also administer the Depositories Act. And whatever orders we pass, there is an appellate mechanism called the Securities Appellate Tribunal. Now, one thing I would like to say that there is a uniqueness in the power that has been given to us. There are very few agencies in India today which have got all these obligations given to them in one go. You know that there is a concept of segregation of powers between judiciary, executive, and the legislature. In a very small and limited way, the Parliament has given us the powers of drawing subordinate legislation, for example, on mutual funds, on takeover, on prevention of insider trading, and there are a whole lot of regulations that we do. We can draft and implement the regulations with the approval of SEBI board. We don't have to go to government or the Parliament for approval. So in a small limited way, we have the legislative powers by way of subordinate legislation. We also have powers given to us by the Parliament to do investigation. So we have got the executive powers, and our members have also got powers to pass orders. We can pass what is called the cease and desist order, or to impose penalty and things like this. In that manner, you will find that we are quite unique, and we have given a quote from the Supreme Court, which also held that these three powers have to be given to SEBI. Now, coming to the regulatory domain, again, some of the areas that we look after are stock exchanges, clearing corporations, depositories, market intermediaries, investment vehicles like mutual funds, collective investment schemes, foreign institutional investors, alternate investment funds, portfolio management schemes, and also, and that is why this has come in the last, because from here will flow our role in the area of raising of capital. So capital raising by the companies is also an area where we have a role to play. Primary market is the market where people or companies raise money from the stock exchanges, and the secondary market we say where the active trading is going on. This chart I'm trying to show that during the last 3-4 years, you will find that while in the year 2010-11, 58,000 crores were raised from the primary market. 11-12, it came down to 12,857. We further, it was in 12-13, it was 15,472 crores. And this year, so far, till the month of January, it is 11,143 crores. So we are likely to be around the same level as 11-12 or 12-13. Now let us go back to 10-11, which was the best year. That was the best year in the last 4 years so far as raising of money by the corporates from the market is concerned. Now, we have done this categorization that of in the best year, that is the year 2010-11, when corporates raised money, how many companies raised money between 0 to 25 crores, so less than 25 crores. Why I'm highlighting this is that this is the group of companies which are most likely SMEs. Because if some company has raised money more than 100 crores or more than 200 crores, more than 500 crores, obviously that company is not an SME. But all the SMEs companies put together in the best year, we are able to raise 59 crores. From the Indian capital market, they were able to raise 59 crores. And now I will bring you to some of the studies about the SMEs, which I would like to narrate two studies. One is a study which was conducted by CRISIL, and they did it in the state of Bihar. Bihar, as you know, is economically not very well developed, and obviously the culture of SMEs is not in the best possible way. But what they discovered, they did a survey of 100 companies in the state of Bihar, and they found that of these 100 companies, this was for a 3-year period, 2008-09 to 2010-11, they found that in these 100 companies, the compounded annual growth rate of fixed assets accretion was around 30%. Which means the companies were investing money in creating fixed assets, plants, machinery, etc. 30%. The money brought in by the promoters in the same time period had a CAGR of 26%. So if 30% was being invested in plant and machinery, around 26% was coming from the promoters themselves. But bank finance was growing at the rate of only 17%. So you can see that there was a huge gap between the need of capital or the capital invested by the companies and the capital provided by the financial institutions like banks. And then they have come to a finding that because of this, while the fixed asset accretion was 30%, the amount contributed by the promoters was 26% compounded annual, the sales growth was only 10%. And the profit after tax growth was only 2%. So this study by CRISIL highlights in that particular sample that there is acute need for the growth of the SME sector to reach their true potential. If they wanted to reach their true potential, they had very high potential, but they were constrained by the absence of capital. There is another study by HSBC Global, and this has come in February 2014. And this study, in the context of relative slowdown in the Indian economy, is pointing out that both the growth and the margins of the SMEs are declining. More importantly, and this is perhaps not very well discussed or argued in general public debate, they are having more stress than the large companies. 70% of SME companies are debt is stressed compared to 30% for large and mid corporates. The study also shows that in the last 1 or 2 years, the working capital cycle for SMEs have stretched to 130 days versus 90 days for mid corporates. So obviously when the big corporates or mid corporates are under any stress, they would delay the payment to the suppliers, and SMEs will be the one who will be suffering on this account. So the cycle has gone up and the financial risk thereby is increasing, and the alternative source of risk capital is in the interest of SMEs, not only in the interest of SMEs, but also in the interest of the financial stability of the country because of their role. And I'm sure you are aware that almost 45% of the manufacturing is done by the SMEs in the country. You must be aware that a very high portion of the exports happen through the SMEs. So it is not only a question of one particular SME gaining or suffering, it is the question of the entire economy. So the importance of the SMEs comes to that. Now, for allowing the SMEs to raise money, over a period of time, SEBI and the government have been taking some initiatives. In 1991, government and SEBI had been formed, but the SEBI Act had not been passed, so it was mainly an initiative of the government. They set up what is called the Over-the-Counter Exchange of India, OTCEI. But that experiment failed. There were hardly any listing. It could not function. and that had to be amended. Although the institution exists, but there is hardly any listing or hardly any trading. In 2005, January 2005, SEBI came out with a separate segment on Bombay Stock Exchange. It was named IndoNext. And the idea was that small and medium enterprises could be listed on that particular platform. Let me take you back to what is called the regional stock exchanges. I'm sure many of you are aware that we had earlier what is called the regional stock exchanges. And the primary idea behind regional stock exchanges was that they would be able to promote the growth of small and medium enterprises within their state or within their area. In order to help the RSE, government came out with a notification that any company which has its headquarters in a particular place, then they must compulsorily get listed in the regional stock exchange. In hindsight, that promotional decision came out to be the most difficult decision, and because of that, the regional stock exchanges could not flourish because they had assured income by way of listing fees from these companies. And the idea was that if I'm a small enterprise in Kerala, who in Ludhiana or Delhi would know about me, but definitely in Cochin Stock Exchange, investors would be knowing about me, and they might be there willing to invest. But the fact remains that there was no promotion done. The risk management system was endangered, and ultimately, almost all the regional stock exchanges have closed off. And government had to later on withdraw that particular notification mandating that there will be compulsory listing in the regional stock exchanges. So in 2005, this IndoNext platform was started. In 2008, SEBI came out with a discussion paper. In 2009, I'm giving the sequence so that you can appreciate that over a period of time, it has been the effort of SEBI and of the government how to provide the SMEs to raise money from the market. Then in 2010, SEBI came out with another platform because the IndoNext platform had not been successful. And finally, in 2012, SEBI came out with certain changes in that platform. Now, the question would naturally arise that why these successive experiments failed? And why, and what is the purpose and what is the status of the 2012 initiative? All these experiments failed because we have two divergent and contradictory demands. On the one hand, SEBI has to ensure that the investors' money is safe. The investors' interests are protected. I'll take you back to my first slide where we are saying that what is the mandate of SEBI Act. So on the one hand, we had to promote and protect the interest of the small investors. On the other hand, we had to do something so that small and medium enterprises are able to raise money easily. Our requirement for large corporates when we allow them to raise money on the stock exchanges is that in good old days, some of you might be aware that we had something called the Controller of Capital Issues sitting in North Block where Mr. Chandrasekhar was also working. And the Controller of Capital Issues used to decide which company, how many shares, at what price they would be issuing. So that was decided by the government. Obviously, after SEBI Act, we have moved away from that. SEBI does not decide the price. But how does SEBI protect the interest of the investors? The only way it can protect the interest is it can insist on disclosures.